Hi, this is Pat Johnson, your psychology instructor, and in this mini-lecture, we're going to talk about methods of studying the brain. Specifically, we're going to mention the EEG, the PET scan, and the MRI. Now, the EEG, the PET scan, and the MRI are not the first ways that scientists used to study the brain. Methods that were used prior to these more modern imaging techniques were to watch a person whose brain had been injured and see how their behavior changed. For example, you're studying Phineas Gage in this chapter, and Phineas Gage had a horrendous brain injury where a rod went through his brain. After the rod went through his brain, his behavior changed dramatically, and that was actually a method of studying the brain. See where the injury is, and then analyze what deficits there are in behavior. The EEG stands for electroencephalogram. Electro, meaning electricity, encepha, meaning the brain, and logram, meaning a picture. So in an electroencephalogram, the person has little electrodes placed all over their brain, and they're attached with both tape and an airplane glue type substance. Those electrodes are measuring the minute amounts of electricity that are given off by the brain. In this picture, you can see how the brain is mapped with electrodes and how each electrode is given off a wave of electricity that is measured on a computer. These waves are compared to the average brain waves of many, many brains, and the researcher can tell if there is too much electricity, there could be something like a tumor going on, or if there isn't any electricity or less electricity than normal, it could be indicative of a stroke. Here's a PET scan, and PET scans are really cool because they show the brain actually working. So PET scan stands for Positron Emission Tomography. But what I really want you to know is that the PET scan watches the brain using radioactive glucose. So the patient who is having a PET scan taken will be taking in radioactive glucose, and then the scan is actually watching the brain use that radioactive glucose. And here's how you read a PET scan. Where it is dark red or orange, that means the brain is very active because it's using a lot of glucose. Where it is bluer, we can equate that to what you would say is cooler parts of the brain, meaning not using as much glucose. Here where it shows black, that's totally normal. These are the ventricles of the brain, which are fluid-filled gaps. So obviously where there are gaps in the brain tissue, there wouldn't be any utilization of the radioactive glucose at all. These different brain scans are showing the patient actually doing a different activity. This is the back of the brain, the occipital lobe, and so when the client is looking at something and their brain is being scanned, that occipital lobe should, if it's normal, show up quite dark red on a PET scan. Here, where the client is listening, the temporal lobes will have more activity because that's where the auditory centers are. In this PET scan, we see more activity in the frontal lobe, the front part of the brain, and that's where we do most of our thinking. Here in remembering, you see the hippocampus lighting up, and the hippocampus is involved in long-term memory. And then here where the person is actually doing an activity, we see parts of the motor cortex lighting up. This next slide shows an MRI, and there are probably quite a few of you watching this video who've had an MRI done on some part of your body. M stands for magnetic, so it's magnetic resonance imaging. And if you've ever been in an MRI machine, and this is one of the styles where it's closed, and some people feel quite claustrophobic in an MRI machine. But there isn't actually a huge, huge magnet in the MRI machine. And that magnet allows the scan of soft tissue at any angle. So this happens to be an MRI of the brain, and we can see the different parts of the brain. This would be the brain stem with the pons here, the cerebellum. Here's the cerebrum with all its beautiful folds. We can see the soft tissue in very great detail. Because this magnet is so strong, one of the things that has to happen before you go into an MRI machine is you must take off all your metal. So no jewelry like necklaces or earrings are allowed. And you'll even notice that the furniture in the room looks like cheap plastic lawn furniture. And that's because if it was metal, when this magnet was turned on, that metal, any metal furniture would go flying across the room. And if you were wearing metal jewelry, it could be pulled out of you, out of your ears or the necklace off your throat. So again, we've looked at the EEG, which stands for electroencephalogram, that scans minute electricity given off by the brain. The PET scan, which shows the brain using radioactive glucose. And here we're looking at an MRI, which allows us to see soft tissue in the body, here specifically the brain, at any angle.